our guest tonight is Dr. Jun Sun, and she is a postdoctoral researcher in psycholinguistics and acoustic phonetics. Did I get that right?
Yes.
Yeah, and we want to talk to you about Zhuyin or Bopomofo. So just for anybody who has never heard of Bopomofo, how would you explain it?
Bopomofo is a phonetic system that is used in Taiwan for children to, well, for grade one students to learn reading, to learn how to read before they start learning about characters. So that's more like a bridge. That's like more like katakana in Japanese. Then you can use some kind of symbol, or like in linguistic is some kind of IPA, and then use, that's called Ruby characters, I think. They use that kind of Ruby characters to help you recognize characters. Well, and also the pronunciation of the characters. Yeah, many old pronunciations. Yeah.
Julia, do you want to screen share?
Oh, sure. Let's go ahead and start doing that. I was just waiting for when it was a good time.
Yeah. So I've got the keyboard picture, the picture of the Bopomofo on the keyboard. By the way, I mean, is Bopomofo just a children's name for it? Is it called Zhuyin or what?
Yeah, Zhuyin Fuhao.
Okay.
Zhuyin means to annotate the sound or the pronunciation. Fuhao means symbols.
Okay, yeah. Very good. And, you know, I know that there are other ways of doing this. For instance, as a foreigner, when I was trying to study Chinese Mandarin, it was taught to me in Zhuyin, but also it was suggested that I could learn pinyin. Can you tell us a little bit about the difference and what is good about Zhuyin as opposed to pinyin?
Oh, okay. Then we can talk a lot, but I'm not sure whether I can remember all the differences or similarities.
Julia, you can go ahead and screen share.
It disabled it. You have to approve me. That's why I'm still sitting here.
I have to approve it.
Yeah, okay. It does that every time now. That's the one new feature of Zoom.
Okay, hold on. So I think I checked multiple participants can share.
Okay, there we go. Okay, so now,
sorry about that.
Sorry, proceed. Sorry about that, everybody.
Okay, we are soon going to see them. Okay, so there they are in all their glory on my telephone. Mm-hmm. June, I'm sorry I just interrupted you because you were going to say something about comparing that to pinyin.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. So Zhuyin consists of Zhuyin Fuhao means that all the symbols are unique. Okay, all the symbols were created uniquely. They look like characters. But pinyin, I'm just talking about how they look like. But for pinyin they use alphabets, right? The older like English letters, English alphabets.
Romanization is
that's right. Yeah, that's right. And then you use pinyin, and if you speak English or you speak German, of course, when you just start learning, it's easier, it's quicker for you to be able to pick up the sound, because that's like if you have BA, then you know that's probably ba, and then it's easier for you to start. And for Zhuyin, because that's a unique system, it doesn't exist in any other languages or any writing system, because it was created, I think it's in 1918, by a group of scholars back in China. And then you have to memorize the mapping between the symbols and the pronunciations. Then there are 37 of them, but for 37 symbols, but for English, let's not say alphabet. Only alphabets, then there are only 26, right? So it's easier to start. But then later on, if you already really memorize all the pronunciations for each single phonetic systems in Zhuyin Fuhao, then actually it will help you pronounce the, it will help you more accurately pronounce the words, okay? The pronunciations will be more accurate because it's not like when you, if you rely on pinyin, rely on alphabets, then you might be influenced by your native language, English or German or Spanish, because they all use alphabets. And then your pronunciation might be less accurate compared to people who learned a Zhuyin. That's, I think that's mainly the difference from the point of view of learning.
Okay. Let me
just
tell you.
A quick question.
Go ahead. Sorry. Go ahead.
I just had a quick question. Do you think for a foreigner who has no background in learning the language that this would be an easier way to learn, or would it be better to learn the traditional method?
Traditional method, you mean Zhuyin or Pinyin? You mean Zhuyin?
Zhuyin is the traditional, right? With the traditional characters, right?
Yeah, for people from Taiwan, that's traditional. For people from China, they will say pinyin is traditional.
Oh, okay.
Of course, yeah, because yeah, it's a there's a little bit history there, but we are not going to go into that. Yeah. So I would say to start, it's more difficult to learn Zhuyin Fuhao. It's more difficult to memorize all the pronunciations of the 37 symbols, right? And yeah. I'm from Taiwan. I would like to say that it's easier to learn Zhuyin Fuhao, but I don't think that's the case. But once, I mean, the learning curve is there, right? But once you go through that stage, then it's easier than pinyin, because pinyin is very confusing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, later, it's easier in the beginning, but later on you will have a hard time pronouncing a lot of certain words. Then you're not sure whether that's this one or that one, and the whole system is confusing. Yeah, for instance, I can give an example. For instance, like the, for the word doi, that means yes or correct or right, like correct, right. And then in Zhuyin, you just use three symbols, and that's doi. But then in pinyin, they make it is D-U-I. Then if you are not familiar with the pronunciations of those words, then you might pronounce D-U-I as dui, but it's wrong. So the pinyin system is not accurate, let's say that.
Okay, it also seems to me that the Zhuyin system is syllabic, whereas pinyin is just segment by segment. In terms of how you divide the sound, do you have some way that you could explain how the sound is divided?
Each syllable can be composed of 1, 2, 3 Zhuyin Fuhao. Yeah, but for pinyin, for one syllable, it can be, well, in Chinese, one syllable is one character. That's usually the case. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So if you use Zhuyin Fuhao, then usually you only need three symbols to compose the sound. But for pinyin, you might need up to 6 letters to compose the sound. Yeah.
Right.
So for a practical reason, you are going to print those symbols on the paper to read, then it's easier to print Zhuyin Fuhao, because it can go horizontal or vertical. But for pinyin, you can just be like in English, it can only go horizontal, and it can be so long that it doesn't fit with the width of the character. Yeah.
Okay, Julia, I think you have the pointer. If you could point to a symbol.
Okay.
If you can go
to such as this one right here. Do you see that?
Is this a test?
I'm just making sure it works. Like,
do you want me to pronounce it?
Why don't we go to the very top left corner?
Yeah. The top, like right here?
Yes.
Or right here?
Yeah. Right
there. Okay. You should go from this line, right, and then you go down. Then that's the.
Okay. So you go. I'm gonna look so.
No.
Ignorant.
Now you go to the first one on the top on the left.
Okay. Right left. Here.
No.
The other side. But the other
where
side.
You were. Okay. Where you were.
Yeah. And then later on, you go down. Yeah. So that's to go downward. Yeah. So this one is B.
Okay.
This one is B. Okay. And then P. M. Oh, then the other one on the left. Yeah. F. And then you go up again. No, not that one. That's just that's Chinese characters.
Sorry.
Sorry, no, that's okay. Then that's D. T. N. No, the other one.
Oh.
Next. Yeah. L. And then
you would go
under that hook.
This one right here, right?
The third row.
Okay, right here?
Yeah, that's right. Okay. K, G, K.
And this one?
K, that's right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That's
K. And then,
stop. Okay. No. Down. Yeah, G.
Yeah. Okay, right here.
Yeah, G, T, sh, the other one. Next. No.
Oh, this one?
Yeah, she. She. Okay. And then go up again. That's
right here?
The older. No, the top.
Very top. One, okay.
Yeah. This is the older children learn. Okay.
Okay.
So, yeah. So that's based on the older. That's based on the position of the oral cavity, where the place of articulation. That's why it's this in this order. And then zhi, chi. Sh, go left. Z,
right
yeah.
here.
Yeah, okay. Z, and then go
then,
up. Yeah, yeah. Z,
and then let's
see.
C, there.
C, yeah. This is C, and then go to the one that only one stroke. That one.
Oh, what? Okay.
Yeah. E. No.
Okay.
The other
no.
One. And then the other one, U. Sorry, okay. Yeah, it's a bit confusing. Yeah. And then go up. It looks like Y, that one. Yeah. A.
And
down.
Then, that one?
Yeah. O.
Here?
U. A. Here. The order is a bit wrong, but it's fine. Let's go up
okay.
again. Yeah.
Here?
And then, yeah. Yeah. I. And then go down, A, no, the other one. A, and then, yeah, go down, ow,
here.
Yeah, ow, and then go down, looks like, yeah, that's right, O. Yeah, and then go up.
And we, here.
Yeah, an, n, the other one, on the right, ang, and then go down, ong.
Okay.
A test for grade one.
Well, you did great. I had no idea where I was going.
No, okay. But your audience might know.
Okay, so maybe for a little while, we stopped screen sharing.
Yes, stop.
There. Yeah, and then we can talk. So from my perspective, when I was trying to study it, I wasn't always sure, is this system phonetic or is it phonemic? How would you answer that?
I would say that's a transliteration system.
Okay.
Because I think, if I remember correctly, I think when they created those symbols, the structure, the form, the look, were based on characters.
Yeah.
Chinese characters. Yes.
Yeah, I mean, they look a little bit like Chinese.
Yeah, a little bit like that, right? And then I would say they are more like IPA, yeah? Because mm-hmm. none of them, well, okay, some of them look like characters. It's true, like E, that looks like characters.
Yeah.
And this one, the O, also looks like Yo in characters. But I would prefer saying that it's a phonetic system. Because,
Okay.
Oh, you think that's a phonemic?
Well, okay. I'm not sure.
Let me tell you
why. So mm-hmm. some of the vowels are also glides, right? So mm-hmm. like this one, it can be a vowel, or at the beginning, it can be a glide. Is that right? Or am I looking at it wrong?
Ooh. I don't know. I never studied phonetics in Mandarin Chinese. So I always have a hard time
like
recognizing
like
those.
Yeah, so E can be a vowel if it comes second position, but first position, it's a glide. It makes a yes sound.
I need a character for that, but I think you are right.
Yeah, because like my name, Aya, the ya, if I want to spell it in
Bopomoko, yeah, then it's I have to. That's right. That's what I meant. I need a character.
Right. So.
Oh man, you just introduced me. My research is about acoustic phonetics.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, but I never studied phonetics in Mandarin Chinese. Okay,
right.
That's my excuse. Yeah.
Yeah, that's okay. I should know all about it, and I don't. I'm still a little bit confused about some of these things.
Okay.
So another thing, sometimes I will try to write something. And it will tell me, you can't put that there. You know, like my computer will tell me, no, after this consonant, you cannot put that vowel. So
you mean it's like phonetically wrong?
Yes.
Okay.
So that makes me think as if it gives me the possibility of writing something that you could never say.
Yeah, because that sound doesn't exist. The combination of certain symbols is not possible. Yeah, that's true.
Right. Yeah, so that makes it seem as though it's more phonetic than phonological. Is that right? Or?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So I guess one of the things that we wanted to talk about is how best Bopomofa uses to teach both small children and also foreigners to help them do the transition from being illiterate to learning literacy in traditional characters.
Mm-hmm.
And for that, maybe, Julia, you can screen share some of the stuff.
Let me
have pictures of children's material.
Definitely do that. Okay, so we have this first picture with the symbols.
That used to be online.
Yeah, even still, you have that. You bought that later on?
No, I had that in Taiwan. It was given to me as a kid.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah.
Yes.
You still have it. That's what I was going to say. You still have it.
Well, I lost some of the pieces, so I don't think I can use it.
So there are not, there's 37 of them. Okay.
Yeah, there are not enough of them. So let's go forward from that.
Okay.
Julia. Okay. So if this were material to teach a small child, June, how would you go about using this to teach?
I like this. I use both. I use both Zhuyin and Pinyin. Because I live in a foreign country, I mean outside overseas, right? So all my computers are in like German keyboard and without Zhuyin on top. So I actually use in both. I also use Zhuyin on my phone. And for this one, this is what you saw, what you usually see in textbooks for grade one. They help you to, like this one is on, and then I think there's the color actually, they didn't make that's a refrigerator, but then the Chinese is 电冰箱. So that's the xiang, but anyway, that's another issue. The xiang, people don't really pronounce it. They don't do it all the way anymore. So it's dianbing xiang, but now people say dianbing xiang. Okay, so not really. It doesn't really reach the goal. And then, so this is ang, and then it's teaching you, okay, that's the xiang ang there. And then the umbrella, that's 雨伞. So that's the first character, that's 雨.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. What was the question?
Okay, again? That's sorry. That's good. Yeah, no, that's good. notice that in the ung situation,
yeah,
it's like the ending of the syllable, right? What do you call that?
Final.
Yeah, yeah, because it's actually the, if we look at it in Pinyin, it's a vowel plus what we would think of as some consonants, right? But
yeah, that's a consonant and then a median. I think that's called, what is the term for that? I don't know, actually. That's an intermediate something. There's a terminology for that vowel used in the middle. Yeah, but I already told you I don't study Chinese phonetics, yeah, so I'm not familiar with those terms. Yeah.
Yeah. So it looks like.
Okay, we have unset and coda. Yeah.
Then yeah. That's coda. Easier. Yeah. Coda.
Yeah. Yeah. Coda. So yeah.
It's coda. Yeah.
Yeah.
So there. Yeah, you have three in the last word xiang. You mm-hmm. have three symbols.
Symbols. Yeah.
Yes. One of them is for the initial consonant, one mm-hmm. is for a glide, and then mm-hmm. the coda, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And, but below in the U, it's the whole word, the whole character is just that one symbol for sound.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so... I don't know what to say about that, but it's kind of very different from Pinyin, right?
Pinyin will be YU.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, and that's why it's confusing, because in Yang, that's also Y.
Yeah.
For instance, yeah right? Yang, yeah. That's YANG, and Yu, that's YU. So that's why I said Pinyin is a confusing system, but Zhuyin will not get you confused, because that symbol U, then that's U. You won't get another possible pronunciations. Yeah. And then I don't know, they in Pinyin they like sharing, I think. They like using the same symbols for different consonants.
Well, yeah, in this particular case with the YU, it's mm-hmm. it's very confusing, because If you're listening to it and you hear this as vowel initial, but mm-hmm. they're telling you that it begins with a glide, which is different, right?
Yeah, yeah. I'm always confused. You know, I built a lexical database for simplified Chinese. I'm sorry, I betrayed my country, Taiwan. But my supervisor told me to build one, so I did. And then when I had to go through all the Pinyin like to make sure that pronunciations for the characters were correct. And then I was so confused with that system. I always had to write down Zhuyin and then IPA to make sure. I had to rely on Zhuyin to make sure that the pronunciation for my words in the lexical database is correct. Yeah. And let me give you an example. For instance, we have also Yu. So you have yun, the cloud. Yun, that's in Mandarin, you just have, in Zhuyin, you only have this yu, and then plus that ng, then that's yun, that's two symbols. Transparent and straightforward. But in Pinyin, then that's yun, so that's yun. I don't know why we need that y there. Okay, so you have yun. Yeah, yeah, right? But you can have just yun, that's yun. I don't know, but U is also used in other, that U in Pinyin is also used in some other places. And then the U, no, that for U, okay, see, I'm already confused. You have the character Nu, that's female, right? Woman.
Yes,
nu.
Yes.
Then in Zhuyin, that's just N, U, Nu, but in Pinyin, that's N, V.
Really?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
Yes, now you know. Now you know.
Why?
So I think they borrowed a few symbols from Russia.
Oh, interesting.
From Russian. So you have X So you see X and you see V in their pinyin system. So X is for xi and V is for u in certain syllables, for certain syllables.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so they use both YU and V for the sound u, for the symbol u, like that one, 雨伞, u in Zhuyin. That's what I mean by confusing. I'm always so confused about those.
Yeah, I agree. That is very confusing.
Yeah.
Okay, Julia, let's go on.
Go to the next one.
Yeah. Okay, so that's all of them, but we're not going to go over all of them.
Okay, but just to show an example. And then go to the next one after that?
Yes, yeah. Okay, so this is from a book, actually, that you were using to teach June a long time
really?
Ago.
Really? Oh, man, I don't remember anymore.
Yeah, okay.
That's so cute.
Yeah, it's very cute.
Yeah.
So I wanted to ask you, because our other colleague, Kate Gladstone, likes to teach, she is a teacher of handwriting, and I was wondering, do you teach the strokes, the particular strokes when you teach popomofo to a child? Do you teach them what to make first and what next?
Before first grader start learning popomofo, they have to learn strokes first. Like they have to, they draw first. Like this, like that, or whatever. I don't remember. That was too many years ago. Before that, they learn about strokes. Yeah, like how to draw those. And then later on, they will start learning this. And yes, you have to write from left to right and from up to down to button. Mm-hmm. Sorry. Yeah. That's the order of writing. The order of writing for Chinese characters is fixed. So, and that starts with Zhuyin Fu Hao as well. So you go from left to right, up to bottom, and then outside, outer first, and inner, like that, if there's anything.
If like you we have the air, how the first one,
like this. That's one stroke only.
Mm. Okay.
I think they always, I don't know why they put that cute figure there. I don't know what the purpose is. I couldn't see any pattern. I think it's just they are being cute.
Oh, so it's not telling you where to start.
Is it the first one? Let me see. No, because if that's, let's say, Bopomofo, you know the fur, right?
Yeah,
that one. That's the second stroke. So that's fur is like this, this first, and then this. So that's not always the second, and that's not always the first stroke that the cute figure signifies. Yeah.
Okay. Well.
So I don't know. Chaba just being cute only. If you see that, can you recognize owl? Like that's the second line from the bottom. And then from your right or from my right? Right, the second one.
Yeah.
That one is the last stroke. Ow.
Yeah.
This, yeah? That's the last stroke.
Like this?
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
But indeed, you do pay attention to the order of writing for popomofo as well.
Okay, so that also... So it's not just how to read, but it's also how to write when you learn popomofo.
Yeah, for instance, if you write E like this, and if you write like this, for instance, if you're left-handed, then you will write like this, right? And if the teacher is being very conventional, then you get corrected. You have to write from left to right instead of left to right to left.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So that symbol E.
Okay, let's see.
Oh, I didn't realize until you asked, actually.
Okay. Okay, good. Well, then we're all learning something.
Yeah, yes. I'm learning a lot.
Yeah.
Did you want me to advance or keep it on this slide?
Let's advance. Let's see what else we have.
Okay, there we go.
Okay, so it seems to me in this illustration from Hua Mulan, that they have some kind of popomofo thing going in the picture. Can you see that, June? Is it popomofo or is it just
part? Yeah, that's the da da da. That means the noise made by the horses when they are running. What is the word in English?
Onomatopoeia.
Yeah, that's right. Thank you.
Clip-clop. Okay, yeah.
Like that.
Okay, that's nice. So in whenever you have something like manga, is there a lot in popomofo rather than...
They don't use popomofo. They just... I shouldn't say that so quickly. I don't remember anymore. I used to read so many mangas, but usually from what my first intuition, my first memory impression was like they still use characters to represent the sound like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But sometimes I think they also use popomofo. I would imagine they would for some sound that is not possible for you to borrow a character, right?
Then
you would use that. But this one use da da da. They could have found characters as well. But then if you use a character, that character might mean something. Mm-hmm. Then that's probably what they want to avoid if they use Zhuyin Fu Hao to illustrate the sound, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. There is one character like O that makes the O sound that
this one?
No, not the popomofo, but there's actually a Mandarin traditional character that only makes the sound and it doesn't have any meaning besides that. Yeah.
Two of them, I think. Some of them.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, not that.
No, past, not that one.
Call you Aya, right? It is the other one.
Yeah. Okay. Let's go on, Julia. Yeah, let's advance. Okay, so this is a reader for how old a child would be still reading.
This is also a test. Grade 3.
Okay.
If one of your audiences is a Chinese teacher, I'm in trouble. grade 3, I would say. Grade 4 even, probably. Okay. I think from grade 5th, then grade 5, sorry. From grade 5, then they don't have popomofo anymore.
Okay.
But that's in my era, if I remember correctly. And don't tell people how old I am. Enough to not remember. But I think this is grade 3, grade 4, possibly, yeah.
Okay, good to know. Good to know. Okay, let's advance.
Many complicated characters in that text.
Yes.
Tyler. Oh, to learn the word, to learn that character.
Yeah.
So the first one, the popomofo in the circle, that one is the. Mm-hmm. Right, and then that is used in that character de. So I'm talking about the greenish one, that one, the paper one. Yeah, that's paper, I think. Yeah, and then so you have de there, and then you see the popomofo, and then where do you use this character? By de, so it means of white. That's another linguistic problem, right? You have in Chinese, those adjectives is more like stative verbs, but that's not going to that issue. I don't know anything about Chinese linguistics, yeah. And then the is to make that become an adjective.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so now it's white, not just whiteness, let's say that. Yeah. And then the other one is le, and that Zhuyin on top, that's le, and then used for that, to annotate that, transcribe that character, then that's le, and then you plus that dot there, that means unstressed, yeah? So that's le. So kai le and le, then in Chinese, marks past tense. So kai le, the flower is, I don't want to say it's blooming. It's the flower opened.
Yes. So what I notice when I look at this is, yeah, they seem to be teaching the d and the l, but they're also teaching the thing, the unstressed vowel that goes with that. So they're matching the vowel, or they're keeping the vowel the same, and they're changing the consonant.
That's also like the second syllable, right? The bite. That usually, if you have unstressed syllable, that's the second syllable that is doing the job. So it's bite and kyle. But I don't think that's because of that's the vowel that the vowel is also used in other stressed syllables. Is that why you say that they use in unstressed for only unstressed syllables? I don't think that's the case.
Okay. Well. Maybe we should also talk about the other marks, because we talked about the consonants and the vowels and the end of the syllable coda, but we really didn't talk about the tone, right? Did we talk about the tone?
No.
So, okay. Why don't you fill us in on the tone as well?
The tone, officially, we have on the textbook, or some books they would say, okay, there are four tones, but some books or web pages, they will tell you that there are four or five tones in Mandarin. It depends on how you define, and we are not going to argue. Anyway, there are four or five tones. Four tones is like, I'm going to pronounce the tones. Ma, 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 ma. So if we don't say anything, that would be mm. So you have this, you feel the musical melody there. Ma, 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 ma. And then when it's unstressed, and then just like that. Duh. Yeah, then that's the fifth tone. If people count that as an official tone, then they are, then the unstressed. That one, the fifth tone, then in total we have five. And I think that's a phonological thing that I don't know what they are doing there anyway. I'm never interested in phonology anyway. And then so
I'm so sorry, because I love
I'm not. I don't like phonology. I'm always so confused. Yeah. So anyway, so we have from tone one to tone four. So tone one is ma, tone two ma, ma, ma is tone four, like that.
I noticed over here with the d and the l, you know, in the second syllable, that these are very, very grammatical morphemes, aren't they? They're very reduced.
Oh, yeah, they are reduced. That's true.
Okay.
But yeah, they are for grammatical functions. It's true too. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, grammaticalization.
Good enough
to know. I never think of that. I never know.
Okay. All right. Okay. I'm sure that there was another more robust form in the past, but we won't talk about that. Okay, Julia, let's go on to the next one. Yeah.
But speaking of unstressed syllables, to be honest, in Chinese, in China, a lot of second syllables are unstressed, and they are not for grammatical reasons.
Second syllables, like in names, for instance, or what?
No, not just names, just usual words. The second syllables are unstressed, many of them. Yeah. Okay. But not in Taiwan Mandarin, it's in Chinese Mandarin. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this was my attempt to write a pretend letter. And the purpose of this is that we have a video showing how I try to use the bopomofo.
Yeah, for me to play the video, I'm going to have to go out of share and then bring it back up, guys. So I'm going to go out for a second and then I'll bring it back up.
Okay.
Because it doesn't play in the screen slide for some reason.
Oh.
But anyway, proceed. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So the next topic or the next question is, how do people use a bopomofo on their phone or on their computer to input Chinese characters? How does that work? And what is the software behind it? What is the idea behind it?
I don't know the software behind it. I have no idea. But I think in Taiwan, you know, I already left Taiwan like more than a decade, yeah?
Don't remind me because you know how long I left Taiwan?
2 decades. Longer than me, yeah. Okay, that's true. So let's start with your first question, how we put in, you just type like, you just spell the sound. So you have 我, that would be like, earlier you have 我爱你, yeah, I love you. So you just type 我, and then now you have smartphones, then they give you a list of, yes, they give you a list of, oh, okay, you have 包 there, then I just say 包. Then you have 包, and then?
Then it predicts it. See, I didn't
that's
have
that's right. Based on the frequency of use by users.
Yeah, yeah? Exactly. Right?
So you will get it, like, if you don't know any Chinese characters, but you do know how to use Zhuyin, then you have a very high chance to be able to select the correct character if you go by the first one. Yeah? And then, so here you have U, O, and you just, then you get to select. But you can also specify your tone. If you know U, O, Wo, that's the third tone, then you can not click. You can finger tip. I don't know how to say this. Okay. Yeah. Then you press on U, O, and then that hook there, that's the third tone. And then you get Wo.
See, I can even get a heart by doing
eye. You can get many, so many different kinds of smileys, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does this with pretty much any language nowadays. I've noticed, like, I type out every word, but apparently some people, like, it just suggests all the words for them, and I'm like, I didn't know people did that.
No, you didn't forget your Chinese. Have you been learning Chinese?
No, not at all.
Oh, you just prepared.
I prepared. Today. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, like here is, yeah, okay. Yeah, and then what was your second question again?
Okay.
So, I already answered your third question. I don't know the software behind that. I have no idea.
Yeah, so there must be a dictionary. I guess that's what I'm asking about.
Oh.
So there is a dictionary behind all this, right?
Yeah, of course, yes. Yeah.
And so I remember that there are several different ways to look up words, and one of the ways is by the strokes. Some people look up words in the dictionary.
Yeah, that's 仓颉. That's another typing system. So in Taiwan, if I remember correctly, I don't use 仓颉. So they have a 仓颉, and that's based on, like you said, you use like, I think, how do you type 仓颉? I think 仓颉 is mimicking the shape of the character. I don't know how to type it, but I don't know how to use it. And then Xiaoxiami, there's another Xiaoxiami, but that's a long time ago. I don't even know whether it still exists. And to be honest, To be honest, I'm not updated, so I don't know what people in Taiwan use. But I'm still using Zhuyin anyway. But my friend Robert, if you still remember him, he used 仓颉. And I use Zhuyin or Pinyin like that. Because I can also use Pinyin to type traditional Chinese. Yeah.
Right.
And if I type on my computer, then it's easier for me to use Pinyin. If I type on my phone, then when I don't like China, then I type in Zhuyin.
Okay.
When I feel angry with China. Yeah. And that happened very frequently. I don't want to get banned by YouTube, so you should cut off that part.
Yeah, so you think China's behind YouTube?
I think so.
Okay. I get that feeling sometimes.
It kind of makes you wonder about some changes recently.
Yeah.
But that's a good point.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you should cut that part off for sure. I'm sorry. Yeah.
That's okay. Is there anything else that I didn't ask? Julia, is there something you want to ask?
I feel like I'm just trying to make sense of all this and learn. Like, I'm going to have to watch it in the replay to get grasp more. But I feel like I learned a couple things. I'm just kind of absorbing things because I don't have any expertise in this background. But it was interesting hearing about it.
Okay. Well, June, is there something I didn't ask you, but that you think is significant that people would want to know about Zhuyin or Popomofo?
Zhuyin looks much more beautiful.
Okay.
Okay, like traditional Chinese characters, they look so pretty. You know, they stand there, they sit there upright with all the components that are necessary. But I will get into trouble if I say that again. If you use simplified Chinese, okay, when I read simplified Chinese, I do read simplified Chinese. I type in simplified Chinese as well. But whenever I look at those characters, I feel I am, you know, handicapped. Something's missing there. And for pinyin, I just use it for the purpose of being lazy, convenience, that's it. But yeah, and also one thing you didn't ask is that when we type, if you are very fluent in typing in Zhuyin, then typing in Zhuyin is more efficient. Yeah, more efficient than typing in pinyin because it requires less keys to type, right? Okay. Like earlier I said, for one character, for one character, you probably need only three symbols the most. But for pinyin, you need probably until like six symbols, right? So in terms of the number of the keys that you have to press, then in this perspective, I would say that typing in Zhuyin is more efficient. But under the condition that you are fluent in typing Zhuyin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right.
In typing with Zhuyin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And as far as simplified characters, they're supposed to be easier to write, but they're not easier to read, right?
They share too many characters. That's my opinion. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they just look ugly, to be honest. Oh my God, I'm going to be scolded by some of your audiences. But that's my personal opinion, okay? And my opinions are biased. Yeah.
That's okay. That's okay.
We like that, actually. We like to hear the truth.
Mm. Yeah, yeah. Because they try to, how do you say that? Make it easier for people to learn. Because in the past, I think there were many people who didn't know how to read, that they were illiterate. So the Chinese government actually did that out of goodwill. So they make it simple, and then but I think they did a good job for in terms of simplifying those characters. They use the same, for instance, let me give you an example, like for the word dry. Okay, no, that's not a good example. Tofa, right?
Hair.
Yeah, hair. Then they use a character that means to send, to distribute for the meaning of hair. So the hair and to distribute, to send, they share the same character. Mm. And that they did that based on the pronunciation because In Taiwan, we say tou fa, that's the third tone. And I think if I'm not wrong, then in China, they say tou fa, I think. Yeah, they say tou fa, and that's all. And so if you are going to send an email, then that's fa, an email. So that's fa, that's why, I guess that's why they use the same character to mean two different things, like entirely different. One is a noun, one is a verb. And then the other one, the most, then sometimes, you know, yeah, on YouTube we can see that people who make their show using simplified Chinese, but in order to please audiences who use traditional Chinese, they convert their simplified characters. But then you will see mistakes in those converted traditional characters because of what the kind of simplified system they use. For one example is gan. To dry, something is dry, that gan. And then they use gan and to do something, they also use this gan. It's the same, to do something and to draw something that's the same character. Yeah, so whenever they do conversion, then that mistake will be seen in the traditional subtitle, in the subtitle with traditional Chinese character.
Yeah, so Chinese has a lot of homonyms, but the traditional
characters. Homophones as well.
Yeah.
And then, you know, in traditional Chinese, there are already many homophones. But in simple Chinese, they make it even more.
Oh, so there
are even more homophones, so that's even more confusing. Oh man, your audience from China will not like me.
Well, I think we have an international
audience.
China.
Okay. I know Keith's going to love, I know Keith is very fascinated to watch and react to this, so we have a lot of people very fascinated what you have to say. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I actually, you know, I advertise myself on LinkedIn that I am available teaching. I'm available teaching part time for traditional Chinese, traditional Mandarin Chinese. Yeah,
wonderful.
Because in Germany, but I haven't had any students because I didn't really commercial stuff. Because in Germany, I'm allowed to have a little bit of a part-time job, like 8.5 hours per week, I'm allowed. So since I have been very not happy with China, and also my research actually is about simplified Chinese.
Okay.
Right? And then I feel guilty toward Taiwan. I feel I have to make more people know about traditional Mandarin Chinese. Yeah, so I'm hoping that one day I can teach traditional Mandarin Chinese online.
Oh, that would be wonderful. So right now, as a plug for your service, if people are interested in taking lessons from you online on traditional Chinese, they should go to LinkedIn. And what should they look for there?
Speak Soon, S-P-E-A-K, speak, my last name Soon. If you speak with Dr. Soon, you speak soon.
Okay, very good, good.
But I haven't had any students yet, yeah.
Okay, well, thank you for sharing all of this with us.
And, my pleasure.
And hopefully we'll get you some students very soon.
Oh, I'll let you know, I'll keep you posted.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
okay. Yeah.
Good night.
Then, yeah, that's keeping contact. Yeah. Thank
okay,
you, Julia.
Let's do that. It was wonderful seeing you. Bye bye.
Thank you. Okay. Bye.
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 Hello, Kate.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us to talk about Bopomofo Zhuyin, which is a system for teaching children and adult foreigners how to read Chinese characters. And since you are a handwriting expert, we are going to focus on the handwriting part of it.
Okay.
Yeah, at this point, I'm going to start screen sharing. And to focus here, first of all, just to give you an idea. So this is a children's book, a very small children's book. And this is a poem for children about a bee. Mm-hmm. And I will just sound these out for you just to give you an idea how the Zhuyin or Bopomofo helps us to figure out how to read a word. So this word, this character here is Xiao, and it means small. And this character here is Mi, and it means, well, I'll let you, honey, exactly.
I know, one of the few Chinese words I do know.
Yeah, and then there's Feng, and Mi Feng together means a bee. So the title of this little poem is Small Bee. But if you don't know these characters and you don't know how to read them, and you're a small child or a foreigner, these little things here at the side will help you know. This is a sh, and this is an e, and this is an ow, and this tells you it's falling, rising tone. You know?
Okay.
And,
all right.
And this is a m, And this mm-hmm. is an E, and this tells you this is falling tone.
Yes. Okay. So, and, got it.
Yeah. And this is a F, and this is an ong, because mm-hmm. these things are not necessarily divided into the same segments we have when we're doing alphabetic writing. This is mostly okay. syllabic.
And all right. Got
and us. There is absolutely no marker here for tone, because this is a level tone. You're supposed to remain mm-hmm. at a level tone, so it's boom. It doesn't fall or rise.
Boom. Okay.
Okay.
Well, it makes sense, you know, and I knew of this system, that it existed. The transcription system that we mostly see in the USA for teaching non-Chinese speakers to read Chinese is a very different one. It's pinyin, and maybe we can have a session on that someday. But for now, yeah. This is interesting, and I would very much like to know more about it, because basically I knew that it existed. That was it. I know that it is in some way derived ultimately from the conventional Chinese, you know,
yes,
but I don't know,
correct.
You know, from versions of them, but I don't know more than that. And I suspect that many of our listeners will know less than that.
Right. Well, we've already had an explanation about this from Dr. Jun Sun, and we mm-hmm. talked with Julia about it, but
cool.
it was really focused on the sound, and it was mm-hmm. also focused on the keyboard. So here I show you mm-hmm. a keyboard with these bopomofo or zhuyin.
Yes.
So here at the top, you can see these are actual Chinese traditional characters, like mm-hmm. the one for wool. And
knee. Yeah, I recognize a couple yeah. of them. I know yeah. them, but you know, I've seen, you know, Chinese.
Yeah.
I know I've actually seen a couple of these. So with the keyboard, you can actually type bopomofo and the system will assemble it into whatever the characters are.
Well, it won't assemble it into the characters. It will give you a list of options.
Great.
So it sounds like this. It has a whole dictionary of these words that sound like this, and you can choose which character you are actually aiming for.
I see. Oh my, well, that is really convenient. That's really convenient.
Yeah, so that's how that works. But another thing that happens when children are getting ready to write traditional characters mm-hmm. is they also need to know what strokes to make, right?
Yes, correct.
And they need to know the order of the strokes. So I'm going to share with you mm-hmm. a children's explanation for how to make the bopomofo characters, which mm-hmm. are not the actual traditional characters, but they help. So
I'm sure, yeah. And I would assume that just as in the traditional characters or in most systems, where you start and what direction you're going within the stroke makes a huge difference.
Right. So this one is a G, and this is an ng. And over here on the side, it's a wo hui xie, which means I can write, you know.
Oh, yeah. So,
okay.
And of course, this is all looking very familiar, you know, growing up, learning to read and write English and also learning to read and write Hebrew. You know, we also had charts with, you know, numbers on them to show the stroke order and the direction. And some of them, the charts were even color-coded, just as these are. Now, just as a bit of a digression, if I want to share it with you, in the world of handwriting and calligraphy study, there is actually an English language term for, you know, stroke order and direction and the path that the pen takes. And that term happens to be ductus.
Oh.
And usefully for us, the plural actually happens to be ductus and not, you know, ducti or something. So it's super easy. Okay?
Okay, wonderful. So apparently this is the ductus. And
the ductus. And I like to use that word rather than say stroke order and direction. sometimes if people who are impatient with new vocabulary, I just call it the pen path because I like to stick to plain English. But if you want to know the term, there is an official term for this and you can even look it up. You know, so we can, so I will call it, you know, the ductus or, you know, the ductus, or I'll just call it the pen path because that I don't even need to explain.
Right. So what June told us, and let's see if this is correct, is that it goes from top to bottom and from left to right.
Okay.
Would you say that that's correct? This is how they're doing it here?
It looks like it. I mean, judging from the numbers on the arrows, well, in the first one, we actually starting horizontal before we do anything vertical.
Okay, so left,
which would be like what we see in Chinese characters generally would not be what we see in English. You know, well, you know what this calls to mind. When I work with the native Chinese speakers on learning English and I'm showing them how to write a lowercase t, for instance, I have to make sure that they know that in English, it's vertical before horizontal, whereas in Chinese, as here, it's generally horizontal before vertical. So that would be a feature shared in common between Bopo, Mofo, which I'm probably mispronouncing, and conventional Chinese characters.
Right. So, yeah, so maybe I should have said left to right.
Well, left to right and then top to bottom, you know.
Top to bottom, yes.
But a very similar overall pattern, just not exactly the same.
Right. Yes. Okay, so mm-hmm. let me see if I can. Oh, okay. This is about the tone. This
well, is that's tone. Useful. That's very useful.
Yes, mm-hmm. And this is about the reduced tone, and I thought that I had a few more to show you about how to make the...
Well, these are good. Go. Oh, here's yeah. a nice one. Yep.
Yeah. So this
very
is,
helpful.
Yeah. yeah. So this one is le, then these are some vowels, different kinds of and a.
Uh-huh.
So do you have any comments about the direction in which the direction and the order in which they structure?
It looks pretty straightforward, you know. I can, you know, it looks pretty straightforward. It doesn't look as if this is terribly, you know, difficult, you know. I mean, this looks so easy that I'm actually wondering if one of these days, given that everyone in China apparently learns this, I'm wondering if one of these days people or some people might say, well, the heck with, you know, conventional Chinese, we learned this in first grade, let's just keep doing this our whole lives.
Oh, okay, I don't know.
That will ever happen. I don't
know.
No.
That's a misconception, Kate, because first of all, this is what is done in Taiwan. It's not done in mainland China.
I see, yeah, okay. I was wondering, so if it's just Taiwan, all right, if any changeover did happen, one, it would happen in Taiwan, and two, it would not be likely. But I'm thinking, you know, this does not look hard to learn. It looks as if whoever figured this out very rationally, you know, figured yes. this out, you know, did a lot to make it, not only to make it easy, but to be a building block into eventually learning actual Chinese characters that, you know, that these are derived from.
Yes. It's very logical because it's also about the place of articulation and the manner right. of articulation. So it's all of those things are very well done.
You might need to explain that to those who are not familiar with language, spoken language terminology, those place of articulation, manner of articulation, basically what your tongue and lips and teeth are doing as you say the sounds, correct?
Yes. And I thought I had some visuals for that, but perhaps I don't.
Well, perhaps June can demonstrate for us if she has time.
Yes. Well, so it pretty much goes, you know, the Bopo Mofo, for instance, the order in which you learn it has to do with a place in the mouth. So you can probably imagine that the B, P, yes. M and buzz starts at the front of the mouth.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And then you move back. You move back from there as you go along.
I'd sort of figured that out from knowing the name of the system, that there probably was some, you know, sound-based or articulation-based arrangement.
Right. But it was never meant to replace. It's not an alphabetic system, first of all. And it was not meant to replace the characters, but to help
teach
the characters. So this is a very traditional based system. In Taiwan, they do not use simplified characters. They use the full traditional characters. Right. And, you know, the way that the syllable is segmented is based on the Chinese language. And,
got it.
Right. So, for instance, in pinyin, it goes by consonant, vowel, consonant kind of thing. But in Bopomo for Zhuyin, what we're doing is we're talking about syllable onset and then the coda.
The start of a syllable and the end of a syllable, just to make it, just to make this understandable for those who are, not into linguistics terminology,
Right, because the morphemes in Mandarin are basically each syllable is a morpheme. It's not necessarily a word, because there are multisyllabic words, but the morphemes are on the syllable level, not like in, say, Hebrew, where it's the consonants or three consonants or one morpheme and the vowels are another morpheme.
Okay. Makes sense to me. Yeah. So, okay.
Yeah.
So I'm sure perhaps we can hear a little from June at the moment. I'm sure she has a lot to say.
Oh, yeah. Yes. June has given quite a tour through the system. And
Well, it's, very interesting. Very interesting to see this. And so let's see, what else should we bring up? In other words, there's a system. It's been used for a long time in Taiwan. It's not too familiar in much of the rest of the world, but it works great. Let's see, what else, what else is there to say to it? As you know, one thing I wanted to know was who invented this and when?
Yes, well, June said it was invented in 1918, and it was originally invented, I believe, in the mainland, but then they stopped using it and were more influenced by the alphabetic system when they put their name together.
Yes, well, okay, well, that's good to know.
I think what's interesting here is that we have a system for reading that is also helpful for writing, because
good to know.
It helps children and foreigners to learn the stroke order. There are certain forms that are basically they undergird a lot of characters. Obviously, the characters are more complex than that. And also, during the computer age, even on people's phones, you can input the traditional characters using the Zhuyin or Bopomofo.
Good to know, because I remember having seen Chinese typewriters and the time I saw it was in a museum or somewhere, before we had cell phones and therefore keyboards everywhere, and they were, I have to say, huge, like there'd be like the keyboard would be the size of a couch, and I was sitting and wondering, how can anybody type on this? It looked like it would take all day to type a newspaper headline or something. So look, I am certainly glad that there is something like this, I suppose I'd be even happier if I were actually studying Chinese, that there is something like this. Although I think it would still be important, obviously, to learn to write the characters as well as Bo Po Mo Fo, if I will ever pronounce this right. You know, I'm wondering about, you know, at about what age do kids usually move from Bo Po Mo Fo to the conventional Chinese characters?
Well, I shared with June a picture mm-hmm. from the children's reader of Hua Mulan.
Yes. And which became that great famous movie. And now,
Yeah.
I understand that Disney changed a lot because that's what Disney does, but okay. But yeah, we actually know of Mulan. So that was very timely. So you were saying.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I shared with her this reader, which still had Bo Po Mo Fo at the side. I mean, the characters were the main thing, but if a child didn't know one of the characters, they could sound it out and figure out what it was. And I asked her at what age exactly a child would still be reading this, and she said about third grade. By fifth grade, a child would not be expected to need Bo Po Mo Fo any longer.
Good to know.
Yes. Now, there might still be characters that a person did not know when no longer using Bo Po Mo Fo, but then one would learn and figure it out two ways. There's a radical mm-hmm. sound, and there's one for meaning, and also there's context when you're reading a new word.
Right. And by radical, of course, you mean a part of the character. You know, there'll typically be a thing on one side that, you know, this sounds somewhat like the word for blank, and then on the other side, but its meaning is closer to the meaning of blank. And I know that a lot of Chinese characters are constructed in this way. It's just with politics the way they are, I like to define the word radical whenever I used it. I mean, we never know if there may not be more McCarthyism in this country and bad things might happen to people who use the word radical in a video. I want to make sure it's defined. Yeah. Just because who knows what way this country is going.
I don't want to be political,
but at this point, your guess about the future of this country is as good as mine.
Yes, yeah, we're trying to stay off politics as much as possible in the language-based.
Gets hard, but we can try.
Radical, actually, I think in this case, is related to root. And so it is.
But people don't necessarily think of the word root when they're thinking of the word radical. I just want to make it clear, because with English having so many meanings per word, I think we have to be careful. I think we have to be very careful about what we're saying when there's a word that either might mean nothing to our audience or might mean half a dozen different things, none of which is what we mean.
Right. So there's another thing that I thought was interesting when talking to June.
Yes.
I showed her an illustration in the Hua Mulan book, and it basically had some Bo Po Mo Fo in it. It spelled out sound da. And I asked her, why do they have this Bo Po Mo Fo in the picture? And she said, that's the sound that the horse's hooves make.
So it's a little like Japanese, where you have characters, but you have what are known as kana, and one of the things they're used is to show the sounds of things like breaking dishes, insect voices, animal sounds. So that's really interesting.
And one thing she said, one of the reasons why you might prefer to use a Bo Po Mo Fo rendition rather than, say, a character that had that sound, is the character has a meaning. And sometimes when you're doing onomatopoeia, you don't want to have a meaning associated with that sound, you know, a real meaning.
Right, got it.
And so I wanted to show you one other thing about that bee.
Cutest little bee illustration I've ever seen, by the way.
Yeah, so this poem has some onomatopoeia in it. You know, it's a poem and it rhymes. If you look at this character, or apparently this is the sound that the bee makes. I don't know why.
Yeah. Well, yeah. It makes sense. Well, the actual sound of a natural bee is as close to a hum as it is to a buzz. You know, you can go to pages on the internet that actually list how animal sounds are pronounced as words in different languages, so that you could look up, you know, the Chinese or the Russian or the whatever equivalent of, you know, the cow goes moo, the bee goes buzz. And it's fascinating how different they are. For instance, I don't know what a dog says in Chinese, but in English it says arf or woof. But I know that in Japan, they think of it as saying want.
Yeah.
Not
too
far off if you think of it, but unexpected if what you speak is English.
Right. So, yeah, and in Hebrew, a dog says hav, hav, hav.
Yes.
So anyway, what's interesting here is if you had a manga or a comic book, you might just use wong, wong, wong thing.
Uh-huh.
But there actually is a character also that gives you the idea of how to pronounce it, because it uses a different character, plus it adds this ko. So if you see here this square thing, that actually stands for a mouth.
Yes.
And so it's telling you this is for the sound only.
Well, that's great. That sounds really, really useful. So is there anything else interesting that, you know, we might like to know? You know, in a way, this is cool because we're finishing, you know, normally we do these videos live and it looks as if we're just, this whole thing is just going to be pre-recorded.
Yes. Yeah, we did that pre-recorded because we have people from different countries and they're up at different times, and it was hard to get everybody together.
That's good. So anything else to do before we, knock off for the month?
Let's just let our viewers know that next month we are going to be covering your new book.
Oh, yes. Read Cursive First. And if you want to share the pre-order contact info, because people who are interested in pre-orders are, you know, able to contact the publisher, have people contact Bonnie. B as in balloon, O, N as in November, N as in November, IE, at nationalautismresources.com. And ask about how to get Read Cursive Fast. It will be available as paperback and probably also as some sort of ebook, but you will want to ask about, you know, the availability, about just what ebook format it's going to be. I don't think they've settled that yet. But I think you'll like it. And of course, if you like it, there will be other books after that every year, which will be, you know, more precisely handwriting books as opposed to just how to read handwriting. It will be, well, how to write more sensibly yourself. But for now, it will be Read Cursive Fast. Those, you know, there is a website which is under construction. We're trying to debug it. So today it's offline, but by the time this video is on, it will be online. That website will be Read Cursive Fast.com. The book also has its own Twitter account at fast_read. You can be very connected and you can reach me through the book's Twitter account if need be. So I'm hoping that those who have concerns or even interest in, well, what is this thing called cursive and why do some people have trouble reading it? It might sound like an off-the-wall concern, but there are people who are not taught to read cursive and they have to read it. And even if you're taught to read cursive, as I'll tell you next month, there actually was an investigative newspaper report on college freshmen that found that most of them could not read cursive, and this included most of those who had cursive at age 8, and by the time they were 18, they were no longer able to read what they'd presumably been writing 10 years earlier. Now that's a situation. I have ideas why this situation happens and why some of the methods in recursive fast can prevent it, but that must all wait for October.
Okay, very good. And in November, we will be sharing different handwriting stories about how people's handwriting developed over time and in families.
Okay, and we may even have a little bit about how one can improve one's own handwriting. But again, that's all for the future. And I look forward to seeing everyone next month.
Okay, very good. Have a wonderful day, Kate. Bye-bye.
Thank you.